It's a fine afternoon in early spring, and the children are out playing in the park and by the river. God's in his heaven. All's right with the world. Right?
Right. It's a weekday, and normally they'd be in school, but we're in the middle of an epidemic, and the schools are closed.
Teachers are having to make the transition to online lessons, using videos, blogs, chat rooms, and so on, in place of the traditional classroom. Over the coming weeks, Mary-Kate, Tom, Niecy and I will be conducting a series of panel discussions on topics relating to the effect the coronavirus is having on our lives as teachers. We'll be talking about learning management systems, apps and platforms for online courses, ways to keep informed about the crisis and get support, guidelines on researching the virus, fake news and how to fight it, and so on.
I have a lot of experience.
Yeah.
I've been doing this a long time.
Well, that's the thing, you see. I think it's really important to be talking to people who are ahead of the curve here, because there are so many people who are just sort of, this is the first time because of this epidemic. It's the first time that they've really been in this position where they're having to do this kind of thing. So, I mean, that's really why I wanted to make the video, because I think there's a need for people to get this kind of information and to know what the kinds of problems are and what kind of issues we're facing here. And if you have any questions or comments, you can post them to my Facebook page or you can send me an email. Let's get started. We're using a tool called Zoom, which enables us to hold an online conference across large distances. And it was okay, but it didn't work perfectly. And we began our discussion by talking about possible reasons for that.
Zoom, one of the problems I think is going to be prevalent is that so many people jumping on Zoom right now, there's bound to be bandwidth problems.
I've heard that the European Union has asked Netflix to lessen its bandwidth, and Netflix are not providing a lot of movies and TV programs in HD, because they're afraid that they might need that bandwidth, they might need that internet speed for other more important things right now. So right. I'm sure Netflix isn't the only company doing that, that have cut back on their ability to supply high speed internet right now.
Right.
Yeah. Because there may be a need for public communications that are even more important than teaching an individual class.
Yes, exactly.
an emergency.
Netflix is followed in short order by YouTube, then Facebook, and no doubt by the time you watch this video, there'll be others. Teachers aren't the only ones wanting or needing to get online. Demand for bandwidth is surging, and that can only mean one thing. Things won't always run smoothly. There will be glitches. We figure this is a pretty good teaching tool. Is it your tool of choice? We're having difficulty, aren't we? Is your screen freezing up? And we may have reservations and concerns about the technology itself. I woke up this morning to the following news item. But this is the technology we've got. And imperfect though it may be, if we want to get our classes online, we have to use it. There are alternatives to Zoom, and we'll be talking a bit about some of those later on. For now, let's just take a look, warts and all, at what, as teachers, we can do with Zoom.
So you're teaching students in Vietnam from India?
Yes.
Just a few months ago, Niecy was teaching English in Vietnam. Then she went back to her hometown in India for Christmas, and suddenly everything changed.
I'm right now in Chennai, which is in the south of India.
Okay.
I actually came here for Christmas, and then I continued being here because I was working on a project in Pondicherry. But then that wasn't really the reason. The coronavirus kind of like shut down all the schools right now. So I just decided to be here.
Okay, so you're working online at the moment?
Yes, I started teaching online. I in fact started teaching just last week. A lot of Vietnamese students who don't have schools, they are sitting idle at home. So a lot of parents like contacted me and I'm teaching online.
So how does a teacher like Nisi, who has a highly interactive teaching style and develops a close rapport with her students, adapt to teaching everything online? It doesn't hurt that she's ahead of the curve and has been bringing modern technology into the classroom for several years, as this video made a couple of years ago shows.
It's very unfortunate that for a lot of people they are going to be without jobs, because not everyone can have access to the opportunity that I have, you know. And also all the classes that I'm getting are from my previous students. So in case if they are new teachers or teachers who do not have like enough database, you know, to do these online classes, they are going to be hit a lot. Yeah. But the teachers who are starting up online, like for example, this is going to be like my new venture. I've never done this before. I've done it like here and there, not really like, you know, professionally having set number of classes, using a proper video conferencing, you know, application. And there's just so much knowledge. So I think it's just a handful of teachers who are getting into this. There are like an ocean of teachers who are already doing this. So you can say just a few of us are lucky enough to optimize.
So how's this going to play out? Will Nisi be able to recreate online the same kind of interactive atmosphere and sense of rapport that she generates in the classroom?
What's the population of Vietnam? Google. You can't Google. I want you to get.
My guess is she's going to do just fine. Tom's coming at all this from a very different angle. He's got a strong background in the digital humanities, and he's well up on online resources for teaching literature. He particularly likes the option of switching to screen view, which turns the lesson from a conference lesson into more of a presentation. Here he is demonstrating that with a text of Hamlet.
So I'm teaching Hamlet, and we're looking at the opening scene where Bernardo says, "Who's there?" And Francisco says, "Answer me, unfold yourself." And by unfolding yourself, which is a little bit strange for the Japanese ear and the modern English ear, this
stand
feature
and
here,
unfold yourself, and it comes up with a...
Very quickly.
Right.
Yeah. This is the Internet Shakespeare, and I should expand it.
All right. That's very good.
Yeah. Now, this is absolutely wonderful.
Tom's working with online databases and interactive texts and things like this, but we don't have to be high-tech to do something that works. Mary-Kate takes a very grassroots approach here.
Monopoly or any kind of board game, you can print them off online. This is my example. Our last one. I don't know, have you guessed what it is? I'm sure some of you have. It is teaching others.
The bottom line is, we don't have to be high-tech to go online. As long as it works and we can get our point across, that's good enough. All right, well, we've seen how Nisi was able to establish rapport in a one-to-one situation. But what's going to happen when we've got larger groups? Isn't there a danger that the online classroom becomes overly teacher-centered? I talked to Mary-Kate about this, and she shared some of my concerns. To what extent do you think we inevitably lose that once we are in the, you know, an online environment? Do you think it makes it difficult to have rapport and to get the class involved?
I think you can still have rapport, but I think it's so inefficient, this method. That's why I really dislike the online method, because yet not everyone can be doing something together at the same time. You can't really put people in groups and pairs. And the main audience member is the teacher. So they're not feeling that their peers are just as interesting as the teacher, and that they should ask just as many questions to their peers and not just to the teacher.
Certainly, managing large groups online is a challenge. In the actual classroom, we can decentralize the teacher by having students working in groups, and learning can further be disseminated through interaction between groups of students. How can we achieve that in the online environment? Well, Zoom does give us a workaround or a partial solution. We need to log into our Zoom account and check the settings, and we need to scroll down the page. You'll see there are a lot of different options here, and they're well worth checking out, but the one I want to focus on is something called breakout rooms. That gives the person hosting the meeting the option to split participants into little groups. And do I want to check that option? Heck yes! Now students can work in groups and be brought back to plenary, and in that way we can, to an extent, get round that very teacher-centred aspect of a lot of online teaching. There are dozens of videos on YouTube that will give you more details on how to do this, and for a general overview on the use of Zoom for teachers, I would recommend Russell Stannard's YouTube video. Please go ahead and take a look. Aside from Zoom, which is obviously, I think it's the main feature of it is its conferencing ability, that we can talk together as a group like this. Are there any other apps or like features of like online interaction for teaching purposes? Is there anything else that?
There's Microsoft Teams that some of my colleagues want to use, and I find that to be extraordinarily Microsofty, in that it just seems bulky and not as user-friendly as this particular application.
Microsoft probably went in there trying to make it a bit too complicated, and they weren't really understanding who their client was.
Our university just purchased, and I think a kind of expensive package from Cisco, the WebEx, W-E-B-E-X meetings, and for individuals it's kind of expensive.
I've used many, many years ago, Skype was much bigger than any other program, and right. I use Skype, but it's really just for having a conversation and text. It doesn't really have a lot of additional features. And I've also used WeChat, which is what they use in China.
Okay.
It's similar to Zoom, but I think it's quite controlled maybe by the government there, so it's their version of Zoom probably.
Uh-huh. Right.
I think Zoom is probably the most reliable because it's older. So they have worked out a lot of the kinks at this stage. They have gotten feedback from customers. They've tailored it to the client.
Given that we were using the free version and were still able to talk to each other over thousands of miles and three different countries, I'd say Zoom deserves the high rating and the reviews that it's getting. Do you think that this is going to be an irreversible step in this direction, or that when teachers have the opportunity to get back to the classroom, they're going to be happy to get back to the classroom and just do things the way they've always done them?
I think for me, the benefit is that you are being pushed in a whole new direction, and so you have to pick up new skills, new resources, new types of activities, lots of things like that. So I think that's great because sometimes teachers become stagnant, they plateau, and they say, right, I know enough now, and actually you never know enough with teaching. So I think it's great that we're picking up all that new stuff and we can bring it back into the classroom. But yes, definitely, I think most teachers are going to be dying to get back to a proper classroom.
So I would say, like, for example, online, definitely you do not have a personal connection, you know, in the sense like you can't touch, feel a person, right? You're not present with them physically. That's like a big drawback. Okay. But I would still say there are a lot of other aspects. Like, for example, if your soft skills are not good, you can get by when you're physically present with a person. You can touch, you can point at something, and you can explain. But when you're online, you have to say things precisely the way it needs to be, you know? So the message is communicated, it's faster. The goal is really to connect online. So you do whatever it takes. Like, for example, they have a problem. And when I tell them, share your screen, how I could just get involved and teach them, you know, where they can practically see it for themselves. So there are like a lot of life aspects that we can actually teach through online teaching. So it's very much required. But again, you know, you cannot downplay what it is when a teacher is physically present in front of her students and she's teaching. Of course, that's always cool. Yeah.
But I'm very, very pleased with this. I have far less fear of this type of format. Now, it seems it's at least doable. It will be imperfect. But in some ways, we in the university are very concerned about administrators saying, oh, now we have a very fine way to just have the perfect university, which is just no students and no professors on campus, which in some of their eyes would be the perfect learning environment for everybody. But this is a wonderful alternative that you have to have if you're in our situation. And I think that if we use another format other than Zoom, that I see that the learning curve isn't quite as steep as I thought it was.
Down by the river, the children play as if they thought that sunny days would never end. Behind the scenes, though, the classroom as they've always known it is changing, at least for the next few months, and possibly forever.